So I've been working at Microsoft for almost a year, so I thought it could be beneficial to sort of go over the differences between what you experience in, say, computer science classes in college, computer science major, and what you'll actually see in the software engineering industry in tech companies. And as a disclaimer, these are just my experiences, and it can really vary a lot based on, you know, what company you work for and sort of what industry you actually work in. So first is just the overall process. Now, going into Microsoft, I didn't really have too much experience in agile software development, or agile software development, however you want to pronounce it. I did have a couple software engineering internships, and we did like a little bit of agile development, or, you know, variations on it. But at Microsoft, we've been doing it in like, you know, full-blown agile framework. So just getting adapted to sort of how these large tech companies actually go about doing software development was really interesting and just way different than what I experienced in college. Because in college, you kind of just, you know, work on programming assignments by yourself, or, you know, with a small group of people. You know, you just put on the lo-fi and you're just like, all right, what's on the rubric? Let me code this out. And there'd be no real reason to use the agile software development framework in programming assignments in college, because the scope is somewhat limited there, because programming assignments are only designed to take a week, 2 weeks, and depending on the class, if you have a final project, maybe like a month or 2 months or something like that. But when you work at a large tech company and the software product you're working on is years away from release, the planning on that is like a vital factor in making sure that you deliver on the features you're supposed to. Now, the structure of the agile framework that you'll use will vary based on what company you actually work for, but my experience at Microsoft has basically just been the following. So generally, you start with some user requirements, so who's ever going to be using this, or whatever problem you're designing to solve, you need feedback. You know, what is the base level of things required? What are you trying to improve upon? So if you work a lot with PMs like I do, you'll hear the acronym OKRs thrown around, which basically just means objectives and key results. And those are like very, very broad things that are determined for usually like half a year, like 6 months. Then you break those down into smaller chunks, which are called epics, which are a little bit more granular. And then you break those epics down into features, which are, you know, much more digestible or actionable items. They're features. And then you break those features down into user stories. And then you can break this user stories down into tasks, but we don't need to talk about that. But for the sake of this argument, just assume user story is the lowest level you can break it down. And that's like one piece of work that can take anywhere from 1 hour to even like a week of work. And these user stories will be assigned points based on the difficulty of that user story. So if it's really difficult, it might take a lot more time, so it'll have a higher user story point value. And if it's really easy, like just a simple bug fix or just changing some syntax or something like that, and it needs to be a user story, then it can be, you know, 1 hour's worth of story points. And in a given sprint, which is basically just a period of time that you're doing software development, so on my teams that I've been at Microsoft, we've always had 2 week sprints. You'll have some set capacity. So in the 2 week sprints, you might have a 30 story point capacity. So amongst all the engineers, you get about 30 story points done. So a feature might be design this web app user interface. And then it might break down into the following user stories, say like, you know, design the landing page, or, you know, build the contact page, hook up the back end, do testing, build integration tests, stuff like that, where each of the user stories are just very digestible pieces of work you're supposed to do. And, you know, they'll generally take around a couple days to actually code up and implement. But enough about the Agile framework. So that was just sort of the process that I had to get adapted to, because I didn't really do too much of that in college. And all of my internships that I had just did very small iterations on that, or didn't really let the interns partake too much, and we only got like a little bit of a taster of what it was actually like. So the second thing I noticed was scalability. So in college, you don't really have to worry about the scalability of your code too much. Like, you don't really have to worry about hey, is this gonna run on all these different types of operating systems with different versions? How many users can this really handle? How many data points can this really handle? You don't really have to worry about influxes during seasonal periods or possible data outages. Unless that's like specifically in the rubric, but for most of the programming assignments I had, it was, you know, code this up, do this logic, build these data structures, whatever it may be. So basically, if it worked on your laptop or on the lab computer, and you had the logic right, it was gonna work on who's ever grading it. When you're working on a large-scale software product, you don't only have to worry about, hey, is my code actually correct, but how will this scale to however large this target audience actually is? So your code can operate really well with 10,000 data points, but what about 3 million? You might only be in your test environment, in your dev environment, be using 10,000 data points. Well, what about the 3 million production data points you have to handle? In your dev environment, your cloud service is running perfectly fine with 3 simultaneous users, but what about in production when it has 500 or 1,000 simultaneous users? So I had to learn really quickly that although my code's logic might be correct, the ability to scale or perform at scale is really where the bottleneck is. So looking for ways to actually optimize the performance of the code without degrading the correctness of the code or adding too much complexity was always sort of a persistent challenge. Another main difference I noticed between computer science classes, say in college or just your computer science major degree, and actual industry in software engineering is the ability to communicate your code. So that encapsulates both communicating your code to direct people you're working with, so other engineers in, you know, pull requests, or if you're doing, you know, pair programming and being able to work through what you're programming, where you might get experience of that in college. But also, not everyone you work with might be as technical as you are, or even if they are very technical, they are an engineer, they might just not be familiar with what's your engineering or your code base, and you actually just need to reach out to them if that, say, they're on a different team because you need to use their API or you need to get some approval or you're looking at how they implemented something. So having the ability to communicate what you're working on, why it's beneficial in a non-super technical manner, I've noticed is really, really valuable. So in college, you had rubrics and, you know, automated tests for programming assignments. So if your code passed all of the automated tests, you know, you got all green check marks, and you follow the rubric with like the comments you're supposed to include or some brief write-up you're supposed to do after, you could basically just get an A. If you just followed the rubric, got 100 points on everything, then you got an A. Whereas in industry, it's a lot less defined. So with your code, you could be following the rubric and, you know, passing all of these automated tests, but the other people you work with might not know what's on this rubric or what are these automated tests. So you have to be able to say, hey, this is the broad idea that I'm working on and these are the benefits. You know, it drastically decreases compute time or compute resources, or it drastically decreases, you know, our overall cost, stuff like that. And especially when you have to present to higher level management, they're overseeing like a ton of different projects. So it's really likely that they don't remember exactly what you're working on. They might be familiar with the name of the project, but they might not remember, okay, what are the specifics of this and why is this actually a business benefit? Therefore, having the ability to be like, hey, I'm working on this, this is the benefit. Just being able to do that in a simple manner without getting incredibly technical is really, really valuable, and you really don't get that chance too much in a lot of computer science classes where you're just following the rubric. If you do the rubric, then you get an A. Whereas in industry, you could be doing the rubric, but not everyone knows what the rubric is. So you have to be able to talk about what the rubric is and, you know, why it's actually beneficial. And lastly, you're not getting graded in the software engineering industry, tech as a whole, in the typical sense. So in college, if you don't submit the programming assignment, or you submit it late, or you're missing something, you'll get docked a grade, you'll get deducted points. Where in the industry, if you miss a deadline, you know, it's not the end of the world. Like, a lot of teams will have to miss deadlines because something else came up. There was, you know, a compliance issue that they had to deal with, or the other teams that they're collaborating with, there was a lag period in the communication. Like, a lot of different things come up that even just might be out of your control. Now, some of it may be in your control and you want to try to avoid being the constant lag on the team, but a lot of things will just come up. So missing a deadline now and again, it's not like, uh-oh, we're decreasing your salary 20% because you didn't get this in on time. I haven't heard that of happening. Maybe it does, but I'd hope not. So you obviously want to avoid consistently underperforming. You know, you don't want to be the one engineer or the one PM or whatever your job position is that's, you know, constantly behind. Now, obviously, personal things come up, but as long as you communicate that to your direct manager, they can usually make accommodations. And with that, I've found it generally less stressful than my times in college. If you are more curious about some of the differences I highlighted between, you know, sort of overall college life and new grad life, I did make a video on that, I think a couple weeks ago. So if you're interested in that, check it out. So those were four of the main differences that I've sort of noticed between computer science, major computer science education, and what you'll actually experience in software engineering industry, in the software engineering industry, or in just general tech companies. I hope you all found this video useful. If you have any suggestions for future videos, comment them down below. Again, if you want minimalist programmer merch, check out some of the nerdy, techie shirts I've been designing at nullref.co. My name is Michael. We do bad British accents at the end of every video. Check out one of my past videos and my past self would thank you dearly, and check out one of my future videos and my future self would also thank you dearly. That's all from me. Hopefully I see you in another one. Bye-bye.